This is James Taylor, and you're listening to The Creative Life. The Creative Life podcast is a show created for you, the creative. If you're looking for inspiration, motivation, and advice while at home, at work, or on your daily commute, then this show is for you. Each episode brings you a successful creative, whether that's a musician, writer, artist, designer, performer, educator, or creative entrepreneur. They share their journey, their successes, their failures, their creative process, their insights, and much, much more. In this episode, I talk with Nashville-based bass player Dave Pomeroy, and I talk to him about his creative process as a bass player, writer, and producer. And we talk about the Nashville music scene and how that's changed and how he's had to adapt as a music artist to continue to have a successful career and make a living from his music. Enjoy the episode. Hi, it's James Taylor here. I'm delighted today to have Dave Pomeroy. Dave is a bassist, writer, and producer who's played on hundreds of albums with artists such as Elton John, Emmylou Harris, Sting, Alison Krauss, Peter Frampton, and Don Williams. Born in Naples, Italy, he lived around the world before becoming a mainstay in the Nashville music scene. And over the past 20 years, he has raised over $250,000 for Nashville's Room in the Inn homeless program with his annual benefit concerts and CDs. Since 2008, Dave has served as the president of Nashville Music Association, and in 2010, he was elected to the International Executive Board of the American Federation of Musicians. So, Dave, it's a pleasure to have you on the show today.
Oh, my pleasure to be here, James. Thank you.
So, share with our listeners, what's going on in your world just now?
Oh, boy. Well, I've been trying to balance being a musician and being a representative of musicians for some time now. And so I go back and forth a lot, but I've been playing with a new band called the Chemo Sabis. That's a lot of fun, with a great songwriter, guitar player named Ricky Ray Rector and a drummer named Rick Lano. And I've been working towards getting some material together for a new solo record, which is long overdue. And but I spend a lot of my time these days representing musicians as president of the Nashville Musicians Association, which is part of the AFM, which is the Musicians Union of the U.S. and Canada.
And we definitely want to talk about that, because I'm really fascinated about the role of unions, especially when it relates to folks that work in the creative industries. Because obviously we think of unions in manufacturing and some of those industries, but when it comes to there's obviously a long history of unions within the creative industry. So we'll come to that in just a minute. But before we do, how did you first learn your craft as a bass player? Where did it all start, and at what point did you say this bass playing thing, this is what I want to do for a living?
Well, my dad was military, and we moved around a lot when I was young. And one of my first memories is sitting in front of the telly, living in England, and in the early 60s, and starting in about mid 1962, the Beatles were everywhere, and I was just fascinated with the whole thing. I hadn't really analyzed it at all. I was just the youngest of three kids watching the TV and trying to figure out what was going on. And a few years later, I started playing musical instruments, just kind of experimenting when I was around 8, 9 years old. And when I was 10 years old, we had moved back to the States by this time, I decided I wanted to play the cello. And I went to we were starting a string orchestra in the school, and I went to say, hey, I want to play the cello. And she said, well, we already have cello players, and you have big hands. Would you like to play the bass? And so I said, sure, what's that? And saw this huge string bass in the corner and fell in love, and I've been playing almost 50 years.
And so you started on the kind of upright on the string bass first, and then you moved onto kind of bass guitar.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I wanted to rock and roll. And when I think Cream was the first band that I saw that where I could identify what Jack Bruce was doing. The Beatles were kind of I kind of saw them as just an entity, whereas with Cream, you could kind of isolate the pieces. And Jack was one of my first and major inspirations, for sure.
So getting started on like an upright bass and then kind of leaving school, did you go straight into becoming a full-time professional musician, or did you have a couple of years where you were doing something different and then moved into music?
Well, my second year of college, I got in a band and started, I've been playing in bands throughout high school and college, but the second year of college was the first time that I really actually was making money playing music. And so I immediately thought, this is what I need to be doing. At that point, my dad was stationed in Belgium, so I thought the logical course would be to go to London and become a rock star at the age of 20. And so I took off and went to London, and I didn't become a rock star, obviously, but I got a job the day I came to Nashville. The day I came to London, I bought a Melody Maker music magazine and saw there was an audition and got an audition the next night, got the gig, and I lived and worked in London for a year in 1976 and 77. It was a fabulous experience. And then I moved to Nashville from there, and with a few periods of a day job early on, I've been a professional musician ever since.
So with your father being in the military, obviously you were used to moving from one place to the other on a fairly regular basis. So, but you're known more as a studio musician than necessarily a touring musician. Was that something that you kind of did on purpose because you knew what that life was of changing, you know, being in a different place all the time, and you wanted to have more of a kind of solid base to build your music career around?
Well, you know, that's a great question. I kind of had a unique opportunity because I landed a touring job with Don Williams not about 2 years after I moved to Nashville in 1980. And with Don, it was my main job, but he didn't work as incessantly as a lot of other touring acts. So it allowed me to kind of learn to stay in town enough to develop relationships in town. And really my studio experience primarily came through Don working on his records and on things that he was doing. And then as I learned more, it was a very gradual transition from being a touring musician to a studio musician. It was kind of a luxury because Don was known for having a good band and just being his bass player, even though at first I wasn't playing on the records. It really helped my career. And so I owe a lot to Don, but it was also a decision to get off the road. My kids were at a certain age and I was getting a divorce and I wanted to get off the road. And so, I worked on the road full time with Don from 1980 to 94. And then that's when I got off the road and sort of did full time studio work. But I had started playing on records, starting from about in 85, 86, and was very fortunate to work with some great artists, people like Keith Whitley. He was amazing. I mean, we did two albums together, and then he unfortunately passed away. But Keith was a huge step forward for me as a studio player playing on those records.
And it's interesting, obviously, you're seeing it both from the side of a musician and also from the union side as well, where the live component, the live part of an artist's income now is obviously a much bigger part of maybe of the pie, of the general pie for a lot of artists, because we've seen through streaming and through other things the recorded industry really kind of change very much. So you're having to see many artists that are having to tour an awful lot more than they might have done in the past.
It's definitely true that live music is the one experience that you can't really totally live on your computer. and so I think that live, you know, there are challenges for sure. And I think, you know, when you're an independent artist making your own music, paying for it out of your pocket, I think for some people, they think, oh man, why would I want to have a union involved in something like that? But the bottom line is that the musicians union helps musicians protect themselves. And if you have a problem and you're not a member of the union, it's pretty much you against the problem. Whereas it's a support system and it's been in place for a very long time. For me, my real introduction to the union was through, you know, we would do television shows with Don Williams and get paid a fair wage. And if they reran the show, you would get paid again. And as I started playing on records, you know, I'm building up a pension, which is important. But also it's, you know, doing my own records, putting it under a contract means that if someone were to illegally use a song of mine and put it into a movie, it's not just me chasing after a movie maker. I've got the power of the union and the union's strength in numbers behind me.
So, you know, going kind of way back, and you mentioned having living in England for a while as well, you know, way back in the like 1500s and 1600s, they had what they call worshipful companies, which were like early unions, early guilds. And there's a worshipful company of musicians kind of going right back that way. And they have a building, I think, in London, where the musicians of the time would have gone and met and negotiated with probably the orchestras or the other people that they were working for at that point. Today, in 2016, how relevant are unions, especially as it relates to a very kind of fragmented industry where a lot of things are happening online? People are sending tracks back and forth to each other online. You don't have maybe the same studio system, let's say, on the recording side that once had. And does that kind of apply to also what's going on maybe the wider creatives within other kind of unions, within whether it's in design or within kind of art and other kind of creative endeavors?
Wow. Well, that's a mouthful. But you know, I think there's a lot, it's a very complex dynamic we're in right now with technology making a lot of things possible, which are both good and bad in terms of what you can do in the creative process of making music. Technology offers you options that were unheard of before. But at the same time, it also makes it easier for people to take what you've spent your time, money, heart, and soul creating. And the term intellectual property is a fairly new term, but that's what the Musicians Union does. We protect intellectual property of all kinds, whether it's your live performance, whether it's your recorded performance. And one of my missions in kind of taking a quite a drastic turn in my career is to help the Musicians Union stay relevant and to create new business models. In the time that I've been president of the Nashville local, we are growing at a time when other chapters are struggling to retain membership. Nashville obviously is very hip and cool right now, but the reason it's hip and cool is that Nashville is where people came to be paid and treated as a professional from all around the world, but certainly from a regional standpoint. That's what built the Nashville community, and that's what makes it unique. And the union was very, very good to me, has helped me in many, many ways. And so my taking on this role was a way to try to give back and look towards the future. You mentioned sending tracks over the internet. We have a scale for that I developed called the single song overdub scale that covers a musician working alone in his house for someone that he may never physically see. And the whole transaction is taking place over the internet. We now have a procedure for that. But a lot of it has to do with the additional use of music. When you work without a union contract in an orchestra and you record a soundtrack for a film or a video game, and it's not on a union contract, whatever you get paid that day is all you will ever be paid. But if you work under a union contract with a company that wants to do the right thing and is willing to pay an extremely modest residual of 1%, then you can be part of a revenue stream that's going to go on for the rest of your lifetime and even for those who, you know, will be your beneficiaries as time goes on. And we just got people paid for a Geico insurance commercial from a 50-year-old Roy Orbison track.
Wow.
And so that is what it really stands for, and that is timeless. That's what they were doing, and I'd have to go see that building in London you mentioned. That sounds like an interesting place. But for me, it was just a question of seeing that we had, it was time for a change in our union. We needed to modernize. We needed to reach out to young musicians. And when I got elected in Nashville in 2008, it actually started a chain reaction that resulted in an entirely new leadership team for the national union, which I'm now a part of.
And you know, doing all this kind of union work, how much time do you still get to dedicate to your own creative work, whether it's through your working with other people or working your own music projects?
Great question. It's difficult, but I cram it in there. You know, I come home from the office and I pick up the bass and I play for a while. And I take, you know, I just did a recording session on Friday. Had a great time. I appreciate that part of it, more than ever. Just the opportunity to work. I've got a couple of sessions next week. I just, Dwayne Eddy is a good friend and someone who I work with periodically. And we just did a really fun show at the Hall of Fame, Country Music Hall of Fame, for their Nashville Cats exhibit. And kind of This Is Your Life, Dwayne Eddy. And we played four or five songs and it was just a blast.
I remember years ago meeting Dwayne Eddy when at the Chet Atkins convention, which used to happen. I think it still happens every summer in Nashville. And
yes, a fabulous event.
So many great musicians play at that event as well. And so you're obviously in an interesting position because you're out there being a full time player and writing as well and being involved in productions. But then you also have on the union side as well. So you're coming into contact with a lot of musicians, a lot of kind of creative folks all the time. In terms of today's industry on the music side, are there any characteristics that you notice from the folks who are coming through who are getting success in terms of being success as musicians, as full time kind of musicians? Are there any kind of bits of things that you're noticing either in terms of their characteristics or the way their approach to the music industry?
Well, I think there's definitely a lot of things to feel good about. I think that there's the younger generation of musicians who are coming up that I would consider to be like in their 20s, 20s, early 30s. A lot of them are not tied into a traditional idea of I'm a guitar player, I'm a bass player, I'm a drummer. They've learned a lot of different instruments and they're good at all of them. They may be great at some of them. And they are writers and producers and singers and artists, you know, stuff that took me, you know, a couple of decades to kind of assemble in terms of doing more than one thing that they just instinctively were doing from the beginning. And so they create product in very, you know, one or two people are making records or, you know, certainly making demos in the way that we would get together with maybe more players in a more traditional sense. That is still happening as well, the more traditional Nashville demo sessions. But more and more, we're seeing these young writer, producer, artists, and they do all these things, and they ask a lot of very good questions about the business side of things. They seem to be more aware, and a lot of times it's by making a mistake. For example, you produce a track for somebody, and you give them a lump sum total. I'm going to charge you X amount of money to produce this track, and without realizing it, you're giving away all of your musical performances, whereas there's a way to do that under a union contract where you're making the same amount of money up front, but your work is protected so that if that song that you played eight parts on goes into a movie 5 years from now or 5 months from now, your musical performances are one more revenue stream because now people are having to make a living with multiple smaller revenue streams. And so it all kind of plays into that. I think that the young musicians today are thinking in a little more of an entrepreneurial fashion. And also I think that they're seeing the downside of the tech revolution and are maybe a little more realistic in that sense.
And you mentioned some like those occasional mistakes or stumbles that artists make early on. Can you talk about a time when you worked on a project, a music project, you gave it your heart and your soul, you gave it all, but for whatever reason, it just didn't work out like you'd hoped? And more importantly, what were the lessons that you took away from that experience?
Well, there's been a few. I can remember one in particular in my early days of sessions. We did a gospel record with a country artist, and I think he and the producer spent the budget on something other than musicians, shall we say.
Okay.
And the whole thing was very chaotic and kind of weird. And I hadn't really done a lot of gospel records at that point. And I thought, this is weird, but I'm sure that we're going to, you know, that it's all going to work out. And in the end, they stiffed everybody and we never got paid. And I was the leader on the session. So not only had I been ripped off twice as much money, I also felt responsible for the other guys. And I chased and chased and chased and finally located the producer and he was in jail. And at that point I said, okay, I give up. Next time I'll make sure we get the money up front or we at least know that, you know, we're working with people we can trust. So, cause I want to take people at their word and I deal a lot, you know, 20 years later, I deal with these kind of things a lot where people say one thing and do another. And, you know, it's learning to protect yourself without being a jerk about it.
And I would imagine
that's a lot of it. I was always that guy in the band that said, hey, you know, excuse me, but this isn't the amount of money that we talked about here at the end of the night. What's going on, sir?
And I would imagine as well, Nashville, although it's a big city and everything, that in the music side, people know each other. It's a community as well. So those folks that don't pay, it travels maybe quicker, and it gets known around the community.
Yes, absolutely. And Nashville, even though it's growing like mad at the moment, it is a small town.
And it's something that I never really fully grasped until I went there was, as an outsider, always thinking of Nashville being a kind of country music. But actually, there's a hell of a lot of other music that's being made in Nashville. It's always been kind of made in Nashville. And I remember speaking to Dave Hungate, the bass player from who's with Toto, who I think he moved down to Nashville from LA must have been around the time of the LA riots. And he said a lot of musicians from the LA scene, they moved on the pop side and the rock side, they moved from LA to Nashville around that time as well. And that kind of spurred another thing as well.
Well, absolutely. And Nashville's always been about more than country music. I mean, going all the way back to the Fisk Jubilee Singers going and singing for Queen Victoria back in the 1800s. There's always been a very, you know, healthy blues and R&B, and there's a jazz scene here. And then when people, and David Hungate is a fabulous person, not to mention an incredible musician. And when guys like Dave moved to Nashville, it just raised the bar. And, you know, as a bass player, you kind of gulp and go, ooh, David Hungate just moved to Nashville. But you also realize that, you know, everybody's got their own thing. And so I think it was a two-way street in that musicians coming here influenced the music that was being made. And I think the fact that the music that was being made here became more sophisticated and more versatile, I think attracted more musicians. And that's, I think, part of the reason why Nashville is such a hot spot.
So a friend of mine who knew that I was coming on the you were coming on the show today, and we're going to be talking a lot about Nashville and the scene there as well, he asked me to ask you the Nashville number system. What is the Nashville number system for myself and a lot of the listeners that they've maybe heard this phrase, but what is it?
Well, it's a musical shorthand that was developed back in the late 50s, early 60s. Basically, if you think of music, you know, from the traditional Roman sense of, you know, do, re, mi, 1, 2, 3, 4, you know, Roman numerals, it's essentially using Arabic numbers and musical shorthand to write a chord chart that is universal to any key. So for example, if you're doing You're Cheating Hard in the key of C, you know, it's C is the one, it's the key of the song, then the four is F and the five is G. So it would be 11, 44, 55, 11 would be the verse of You're Cheating Hard, which means two bars of C, two bars of F, two bars of G, two bars of C. And repeat signs and these kind of things all apply. And if you're in a minor key, you use the relative minor. So it actually stems from music theory, but it's a really simple, innovative way. The Jordanaires, who were the backup singers who sang on a lot of Elvis records, and they developed a version of it to notate their harmony parts. And two musicians, Charlie McCoy and Wayne Moss, took that concept and applied it to writing chord charts. And in the, you know, in Nashville and in fact, all over the world, the guitar is the primary songwriting instrument for a lot of music. And with the capos moving up and down and different tunings, as soon as the capo moves, the chart is wrong. Whereas if you have a number chart where one is one or six minor is the, you know, the minor, you can play it in any key, and it's a really interesting system that does not just apply to country music. It works for any kind of music. And it once you get used to the language, it becomes second nature. But to someone who's never seen it before, I'm sure it does seem rather weird, because you'll hear guys say, okay, 55, 51, 1 at the top, I'll take the turnaround. You know, and you hear this foreign language, but we all know what it means. And it's just a it's a shorthand way to notate a song, and I've found that you can fit almost any song on one page, and usually, unless it's really, really difficult, someone can write a chart in one or two passes, and it's like, boom, here it is, rather than sitting down with an arranger and transcribing. It's much more flexible and it allows for a lot of spontaneity. Certain lines might be written out, like you might write out a figure, but it will be written out with a rhythmic figure with numbers above it instead of letters.
So I'm definitely, if people are listening to this, I'm intrigued about it. What I'll do is at jamestaylor.me, on this episode in the show notes, I'll actually put some examples of this as well, so people can see what this, what it looks like as well.
There's a very good book called The Nashville Number System by Chaz Williams, C-H-A-S. I'm sure it's probably at this point available. You know, I'm sure there may be an online version, but there's been a number of people have written books about it. But Chaz's is quite good because he explains that everybody, you know, everybody has their own little quirks depending on who you learned it from. You know, it's kind of interesting to see the different variations, because what one person will write one way, somebody else would write differently. And it just takes a second. You go, oh, yeah, right. Okay, yeah. That's right. He does that. And so you kind of learn. It's sort of like dialect.
Yeah. So we'll definitely put this on the show notes. People go to jamestaylor.me, and I'll put the links to that and to the book that Dave was talking about just now as well. So Dave, you obviously give a lot of advice to new players that are coming through. But what's the best advice that you've ever received about having a career in the music industry?
Huh. Well, I think that the biggest lesson I learned, and it was kind of a combination of Guy Clark and Don Williams, was play the song. You know, play what's right for the song. There'll be a chance to show off at some point, but don't make it right in the middle. I would say that Don gave me one of the best pieces of advice was early on in my time with him. Don sort of pulled me aside and he said, you know, Dave, you don't have to play what's on the record. Just don't throw me off. Okay. And that was his way of saying, play the song.
Yeah.
And it took a bit for it to sink in, but I began to understand what he was talking about. And as a bass player, there's a very interesting relationship between the vocal, especially in country music, but I think in any kind of music. I mean, you listen to the Beatles and you listen to the bass and the vocal, there's a dance going on almost all the time. And so it's finding your role in the dance and doing something to enhance but not detract. I think that was probably the best advice I got was just don't throw me off.
Which it can get quite frustrating watching on TV at times where, I mean, you're talking about there about you know, interpreting the song, being kind of true to the song as well, and obviously the great examples in country music. You know, you've got people like Ella Fitzgerald and jazz, just who really they get across what the intention is of the writer and the song, and it becomes very frustrating sometimes when you hear an artist who is just wanting to show their vocal gymnastics and loses any sense of actually what that song is about, or the musician in the band who's just obviously a live show is obviously has been the wrong choice for the gig is kind of playing all over the changes.
Well, exactly, and I think, you know, that was a great training to become a studio musician, and really it producing as well. I always wanted as a producer to be kind of transparent and let the artist personality and the personality of those songs come out and not have to be, oh, well, that's obviously produced by Dave Pomeroy because the bass is way too loud, you know?
Yeah. And I think it was, I think it may have been Nathan East when I was working with Nathan East or it was, I think it was a bass player anyway, who said, when he was talking about, soloing on shows, and he said, your level of, soloing and the amount of times you take solo should be in direct relationship to where you're sitting on the bill on the poster. That was the take on where to come. And it's great because you have artists like yourself and guys like Nate who obviously have all those technical chops and everything, but can sit there and really really play the song, do good for the song, and not throw the singer off as well. So do you have an online resource or a tool like Gmail or Evernote that you really love and you find you're using a lot?
Like most musicians, you know, we've got a studio down here in the basement. I work a lot with a great engineer named Dave Cinco. And Dave works with the Punch Brothers, and he worked together with me, with Don Williams, and a lot of folks. And so we've been in Pro Tools land for a long time. You know, that's kind of been the format of choice in Nashville for the most part. But there are certainly still other very valid things. I think for me, the thing that I've gotten into over the last decades or so has just been all the different effects and loops, loop boxes that I can use for live performance. I'm not so much a fan of doing it in the computer as I am having hardware that I can put on the floor. And I do, you know, loops in real time and with nothing prepared in advance. So, I was never a big fan of the sort of, you know, solo artist who's just basically playing to his own karaoke tracks. I thought it was more risky and fun to kind of build something as you go. And then I use multi effects to change up the textures so that it isn't just layer after layer of bass. And so I've been using the Roland stuff a lot, the RC50 looper, and the GT1 MB is the multi effects. And with those two boxes, I can make a whole lot of noise all by myself, and I sure enjoy it. And I do enjoy the recording process. I think editing is something that, you know, I really enjoyed. You know, Dave and I, Cinco and I, have been working together for years, and we made an album called Thin Air years ago, and we took a bunch of live performances and edited them into one long 45-minute piece of music. I think the tool back then was Sound Designer. It was in the primitive days of that, and we learned a lot, and so I've always had kind of a mind for that, but I tend to want to treat the computer more as a tape machine and less of a bag of tricks. I don't know why. Maybe it's just me being a little old school.
And if you could only recommend one record and one book to our listeners, you think that it'd be worth them checking out? What would they be?
Wow. I would say Cream, Wheels of Fire, for the record. That's, you know, it has the live album and the studio. And to me, that represented the peak period of the greatest band that ever was. For me, I think there's esoteric layered stuff you can hear in the studio tracks. Jack Bruce's tunes on that album, as you said, those just deserted cities of the heart. And then the live stuff. I mean, I learned how to play bass playing along with Spoonful.
Yeah.
16 minutes and 44 seconds of E. And so, you know, I love that. Books, it's really tough. I might have to give you a couple.
Okay, what's the book then that you've gifted most often to other people?
I try to mix it up, so I don't know that I've ever done one more than another. But books that I love, Music is My Mistress, Duke Ellington, is a fabulous book. Victor Wooten's The Music Lesson.
Yeah, that's a great. We had Victor on the show recently as well. Great book.
Yeah, he's fantastic. I mean, I met when Vic first moved to town. He was playing solo bass at the local vegetarian restaurant, and I'll never forget walking in and having lunch and hearing this sound. And it's like, what is that? And then, you know, yeah. And Victor's, he's tremendous. We've worked together. You know, I put together back in the 90s, we did a bunch of all bass orchestra shows where we massed large numbers of bass players together. There's one that's now out on DVD. There's a 17-minute version of a jazz tune called Footprints. That's Victor, Bill Dickens, O'Teal Burbridge, and Steve Bailey. That is just phenomenal.
And he has a great setup, I believe, down there in Tennessee, his camps, which they sound absolutely fantastic. The work he does there with these music camps that he's running all the time.
Yeah, it's the Bass and Nature Camp, and now actually he's doing other instruments as well. I went there and taught a couple years ago, and it was a great experience. I mean, Victor's not only a great musician, he's a great human being, and he's somebody that, you know, we're all very proud of as the bass player community, also from Nashville. I love bringing him into situations where people who have not been exposed to him, I've been able to do that a couple of times, bring him in and interview him in front of other people that are in the business that don't really know who he is. And Victor starts talking about his mother. And starts talking about you know, music should be the language that we learn, you know, as soon as we learn to speak, we should be learning to play music. And you can just see these people's hearts melt when they hear what Victor has to say.
Okay. And we'll put all the links to all these books here in the show notes. People go to jamestale.me. So final question for you, Dave. Imagine if you woke up tomorrow morning and had to start from scratch. So you've got the tools of your trade, your bass in your case, and the knowledge that you've acquired over the years, but you have no contacts. No one knows who you are, and you have to restart. How would you restart things?
Wow. Well, I think I would start by making sure that I could be self-contained and very efficient and be able to, you know, go out and work alone if need be. And that was, you know, the working up enough material to do a whole night of solo bass and vocals was a real challenge. And of course, you're giving me that caveat of having the stuff in my quiver that I already do. So I think I would start there, and I would certainly, I would definitely in this day and age, I would expand, you know, I would obviously, you know, jump into the social media and the various ways of communicating as much as possible. But I think I would also want to keep it very connected to the ground in terms of, you know, house concerts, being able to record. And I would probably not make physical product as I still do. I'm kind of old school that way. I still, when I put something out, I still press up CDs or DVDs. And of course, I would encourage all of my new fans, since I don't know anybody, to go to davepomeroy.com and check it all out.
Well, that's a perfect lineup, because I was about to ask you, share the best ways that listeners can connect with you. So just share with us again that domain name.
It is davepomeroy.com, but my company name is Earwave Music. And so if you go to earwavemusic.com, and that's E-A-R-W-A-V-E music.com, that's the store of davepomeroy.com. On the website, there's a lot of, you know, there's stuff, you know, there's the catalog is for sale at the store, but there's also a lot of, you know, informational stuff. There's things about the union. There's various interviews that I've done and that I've done with various people. There's one on there that I'm really proud of where I interviewed Jimi Hendrix's bass player, Billy Cox, in front of a live audience. And Billy's just the sweetest guy ever. He lives here in Nashville. And, you know, that's another little Nashville tidbit people don't know is that Jimi Hendrix got his start here.
I never knew
when
that.
When he got out of the Army.
And actually, we link it perfectly because I know in London just now, they've just opened up his apartment that he had in Chelsea, I think it was. And it's now open to the public. So next time, Dave, you're over in London, I'm going to take you to two places. We're going to go to Jimi Hendrix's apartment together, and we're going to go to that Worshipful Company of Musicians, where they're just one of the very first musicians union in the world as well. So Dave, thank you so much for coming on the show. It's been a pleasure speaking to you and hearing about the work you're doing as well. And I look forward to catching up with you in person sometime.
Okay, thank you very much, James. I sure appreciate it.
Hey, James Taylor here again. And if you're interested in living a more creative life, then I'd love to invite you to join me as I share some of the most successful strategies and techniques that high-performing creatives use. I put them all together in a free downloadable ebook that you can get by going to jamestaylor.me. That's jamestaylor.me to get your free downloadable ebook on creativity.